Cuba, the largest Caribbean island, is governed by a communist government. The island is known for its gorgeous islands, cultural dances, festivals, white sand beaches, rolling mountains, cigars, rum, and colorful capital, Havana. According to the history of Cuba.com, as early as 1490, the Cubans were in Taíno tribe. Taíno tribes were forced westward some 200 years before the Spaniard arrival by a bloodthirsty tribe known as Caribs. Cuba is the largest island in the Caribbean, and with 11 million inhabitants, it is the second most populous after Hispaniola. It's a multi-ethnic country whose people, culture, and customs derive from diverse origins, including the Aboriginal Taíno and Ciboney peoples. The long period of Spanish colonialism, the induction of African slaves, and close relationship with the Soviet Union during the Cold War. These indigenous peoples performed traditional work of their village. Women were in charge of agriculture, while men were often doing the hunting and fishing, and there were consequences in place for those who attempted to abstain from their duties. From this, we can infer that these examples of family law created social division and show one of the earliest forms of patriarchy. Dating back to the mid-16th century, Cuba was still under control of Spain, which greatly impacted their civil laws and implementations of slavery, which is seen in Spanish civil laws of 1552. According to one of the earliest law codes dating back to the 16th century, new laws consisted of many regulations of the encomienda system, including solemn prohibition of the enslavement of the indigenous peoples and the provisions for gradual abolition of the encomienda system. The new law stated that the natives would be considered free persons and the encomenderos could no longer demand their labor. The natives only required to pay the encomenderos tribute, and if they worked, they would be paid wages in exchange for their labor. The laws also prohibited the sending of indigenous people to work in the mines unless it was absolutely necessary and required that they would be taxed fairly and treated well. The work of the encomienda system portrays example of civil laws as it regulates wages, tributes, and slavery. According to the history of Cuba.com, up until 1899, Cuba was finally an independent country and began to create laws based on their respective. The substantive and procedural laws of Cuba were later based on the Spanish civil laws and were influenced by the principles of Marxism-Leninism after that philosophy became the guiding force of government. Following the defeat of the Spanish, Cuba remained under a U.S. military government until 1902, at which time the U.S. oversaw the creation of a new government. Over the course of the developments of Cuban law, there was the creation of the first constitution in 1901, an amendment in 1934, 1940, 1976, and 1992. Amendments vary from property laws that authorize the limited existence of joint ventures and corporations. Cuban law also permits the collective ownership of agricultural cooperatives. Criminal law was also amended, changing controversial portions of Cuba's criminal code, including vague provisions providing for the arrest of persons committing anti-revolutionary acts. The Cuban criminal law code, however, does not cover international incidences. Daily sessions of the Congress of the Republic of Cuba show how Cuban law was shaped during this period. Lawyers Without Borders organization provides us with examples of their civil law codes, such as the Spanish Civil Code and Civil Defense Code of Cuba. The Spanish Civil Code of Cuba of 1889 remained in effect until 1987, which established the difference between inferior and superior laws, establishing socioeconomic divisions which are still intact today, as well as the division of organic, ordinary, and regulatory laws. The influence of the United States appeared in the form of a Supreme Court of Appeals and judicial review. Cuba emphasizes written codes rather than the precedent as a source of law and utilizes an inquisitorial system of criminal procedures similar to that of Spain and France. But the Cuban justice system also incorporated elements of American law after American occupation. The influences of both the United States and Spanish rule in Cuban law were present decades into the future. For example, the Spanish Penal Code influenced the 1936 Civil Defense Code of Cuba, showing the new principles with the reference to the state intervention in the relationship among people in order to guard their interests in harmony with social convenience, which remained in effect till 1979. According to PBS.org, under Cuban law, an act is a crime only if it is prohibited by the law and is socially dangerous or harmful. Crimes in Cuba are divided into felony and misdemeanor offenses. Prison sentences for serious crime, from 15 to 20 years for first-degree murder to 2 to 5 years for offenses such as trafficking in foreign currency and burglary of an uninhabited dwelling. In 1988, the Cuban Penal Code decreed certain sentences, like from the correctional labor with a confinement to correctional labor without confinement. The 1975 Cuban Family Code covers marriage, divorce, paternity, adoption, and parental responsibilities for the care and education of children. According to LatinAmericanHistory.com, Florencio Batista y Saldivar was elected president of Cuba from 1940 to 1944 and dictator from 1952 to 1959 before beginning overthrow as a result of the Cuban Revolution. Batista initially rose to power as part of the 1933 Revolt of the Sergeants that overthrew the authoritarian government of Gerardo Machado. Batista then appointed himself chief of the armed forces, with the rank of the colonel, and effectively controlled the five-member presidency. He maintained his control through a string of puppet presidents until 1940, when he himself elected president of Cuba on a populist platform. On March 10, 1952, 3 months before the election, Batista, with an army backing, staged a coup and seized power. He ousted outgoing president Carlos Prio Sacarez, canceled the elections, and took control of the government as provisional president. Shortly after the coup, the United States government recognized his government. When asked by the U.S. government to analyze Batista's Cuba, Arthur M. S. Schlinger, Jr. said, "The corruption of the government, the brutality of the police, the government's indifference to the needs of the people for education, medical care, housing, for social justice, and economic justice is an open invitation to revolution." Again in power, Batista did not continue the progressive social policies from his earlier term. He won a recognition by the upper strata of Cuban society, which had never accepted him. According to Biography.com, Cuban President Raul Castro was born on June 3, 1931, near Barón, Cuba. As a young man, he became interested in politics and joined a socialist youth group. In the late 1950s, he participated in the revolution that brought his brother Fidel Castro to power, and soon thereafter was appointed head of the armed forces. In the decades that followed, he also served as Cuba's defense minister, Deputy Prime Minister. In February 2008, Raul succeeded Fidel as President of Cuba, and since then, time has implemented a variety of social, economic, and political reforms in the country. He is dedicated to his communist ideals, which are fulfilled to this day. Castro today often vows to end his presidency in 2018.
History of servitude in Cuba can be traced all the way to the island's earliest indigenous people. The Taino, for example, developed a social class with a chief at the top and servants or laborees at the bottom. The Taino's less advanced predecessor, the Siboneyes, were in fact servants of the Tainos. In 1511, Spanish conquistador Diego Velázquez de Suellar began permanent settlement in Cuba, and the first authorization from the King of Spain to introduce black slaves in Cuba took place in 1512. The main reason for bringing the black slaves was because their strength and performance surpassed that of Cuba's indigenous people. It is estimated that over 600,000 Africans were taken from West Africa and were shipped to Cuba for 3 centuries. In the 18th and 19th century, Cuba was dependent on an economy based on sugarcane and coffee crops, as well as slaves to work the sugar and coffee plantations. Numerous anti-slavery movements arose in the early 1800s, but were violently suppressed. Leaders of revolts were also executed. Although Britain and the U.S. abolished their slave trades in 1807 and 1808, and despite Britain's attempts to pressure Spain into formally ending the slave trade to Cuba in the 1820s, Cuba remained one of the most common destinations for slave ships throughout the 1860s. Slavery was not abolished in Cuba until 1886. In the late 15th century, the Guanacaste peoples, the oldest culture on the island, as well as the Siboney, occupied the western region of Cuba. The more numerous Taino people inhabited the rest of the island. The Taino were a peaceful people and were highly proficient agriculturists. They made pottery, polished stone implements, and developed idols of religious spirits called Zemis. History. It has been noted that an unspecified number of Cubans are non-religious. Religious faith and practice have not been as influential in the culture of Cuba as in other Latin American cultures, and this is primarily valid for 2 reasons. First, in the colonial period, the Catholic clergy were almost entirely born in Spain. They illustrated the external power of Spain as Cuba's mother country. Thus, Catholicism was suspect, especially within the population who supported Cuban independence. Secondly, there were not many priests in the rural areas of Cuba. Cubans who sought to maintain a faith practice were left to produce a religiosity of their own makeup. The popular religiosity which did develop among white and Creole Cubans was a local version of Catholicism enriched with Catholic influences. Santería is a product of this religious syncretism. Santería is a religious system of the Yoruba people of Nigeria who were brought as slaves and is more prevalent in the eastern region of Cuba. It is based on the maintenance of relationships both among people and between people and divine emissaries called orishas. Because orishas were comparable and interchangeable with Roman Catholic saints, slaves were able to put on a face of Catholic piety in the midst of worshiping their own gods. Many religious persons, including priests, participated in the revolution of 1958 and supported its ideals. But when it was discovered in 1961 that the churches were being employed as the basis of counter-revolutionary plotting, all foreign priests were invited to deport the island. During this period, about 70% of Roman Catholic priests, 90% of nuns, some Protestant clergy, and all rabbis left the country voluntarily or were deported. Practicing religious leaders and the faithful were thereafter excluded from some professions and promotion to high government offices. In the 1980s, more freedom was given to print religious material, and in 1991, faith was finally removed as an impediment to party membership. Christmas was also restored as a national holiday in 1997 due to the highly publicized and anticipated visit by Pope John Paul II the following year. Cuba is governed by a totalitarian communist government. Its government exercises direct control and influence over most facets of the Cuban life, and the highest levels of leadership decide what laws are enacted and enforced without any input from its governed citizens. For example, because of Cuba's suppression of religion in the mid to late 1900s, many Cubans are currently non-religious. Cuban society is affected by the laws, rules, and regulations made by the Cuban government. Thus, in Cuba, society is a reflection of law. This phenomenon is very different in the United States, in which citizens or non-legislators influence the lawmaking process through means such as mass movement and lobbying. Thus, in contrast, the U.S. laws are a reflection of society. The United States is currently planning to restore diplomatic relations with Cuba more than 50 years after relations were severed following Cuba's trade agreement with the Soviet Union. The U.S. shift in policy was broadcasted by Cuba's release of American aid worker Alan Gross in Havana after 5 years of being incarcerated. CNN reported a prisoner exchange that also included Cuba's release of a U.S. intelligence source and the U.S.'s release of 3 intelligence agents.
Today, Alan returned home, reunited with his family at long last. Alan was released by the Cuban government on humanitarian grounds. Separately, in exchange for the 3 Cuban agents, Cuba today released one of the most important intelligence agents that the United States has ever had in Cuba, and who has been imprisoned for nearly 2 decades. This man, whose sacrifice has been known to only a few, provided America with the information that allowed us to arrest the network of Cuban agents that included the men transferred to Cuba today, as well as other spies in the United States. This man is now safely on our shores. Having recovered these 2 men who sacrificed for our country, I'm now taking steps to place the interests of the people of both countries at the heart of our policy.
An Information Technology and Communications Ministry was created on January 13, 2000, to, quote, regulate, direct, supervise, and control Cuban policy as regards communication technology, information technology, telecommunications, computer networks, broadcasting, the radio spectrum, postal services, and the electronics industry, unquote. Similarly, the National Security Agency, NSA, is an intelligence organization of the United States government responsible for global monitoring, collection, and processing of information and data for foreign intelligence and counterintelligence purposes.
Controversies arose surrounding the constitutionality of NSA's efforts regarding domestic surveillance. In May of 2013, former NSA contractor Edward Snowden leaked top-secret documents illustrating that the NSA was spying on American citizens, even those who did not pose an imminent threat to the country's security. All of this was done without the citizens' knowledge. For example, one story revealed that Verizon, as well as other American telephone companies, has been providing the NSA with virtually all of its customers' phone records. It was also revealed that the NSA intercepts 200 million text messages every day through a worldwide program called DishFire. NSA's involvement in the warrantless mass surveillance of citizens domestically has raised questions and concerns regarding its constitutionality and violation of citizens' right to privacy. Snowden's revelations have led to numerous investigations into U.S. surveillance and violations of human rights to privacy and freedom of information. Legislative reforms and lawsuits have also ensued.
My name is Ed Snowden. I'm 29 years old. I work for Booz Allen Hamilton as an infrastructure analyst for NSA in Hawaii.
Talk a little bit about how the American surveillance state actually functions. Does it target the actions of Americans?
NSA and the intelligence community in general is focused on getting intelligence wherever it can, by any means possible, that it believes on the grounds of sort of a self-certification that they serve the national interest. Originally, we saw that focus very narrowly tailored as foreign intelligence gathered overseas. Now, increasingly, we see that it's happening domestically. And to do that, the NSA specifically targets the communications of everyone. It ingests them by default. It collects them in its system, and it filters them, and it analyzes them, and it measures them, and it stores them for periods of time, simply because that's the easiest, most efficient, and most valuable way to achieve these ends. So while they may be intending to target someone associated with a foreign government or someone that they suspect of terrorism, they're collecting your communications to do so.